Thanks, guys, for the invite. It's an absolute pleasure to be here. Chemical engineering is a wonderful profession, so anything that I can do to sow into that profession and to sow into that into your lives is actually to benefit me. I get a great kick out of this. So I want to tell you my story. When I was young, I didn't actually know that I wanted to be an engineer, so I want to go through that story and hopefully it's an encouragement to you. About 30 years ago when I was at school, I was bright but stupid. Bright and stupid means that I came second in the state science competition twice, but I didn't know how to study. It made me arrogant, and so when I came to university, I still didn't know how to study, and I was arrogant, and I was probably ignorant as well. In the first year of university, I discovered history, and I'm not exactly sure how I ended up in a history lecture, but as soon as I did that, then I discovered geography and politics, and I spent most of my first year of engineering doing art subjects, unofficially. And so when I went to the Upmuni Library, you have a choice. You can go up the stairs and you can turn left to the interesting subjects, or you can turn right to the science and maths and engineering. And I did not always choose right. Okay, so that's the background. That's where I'm coming from. And so I was lucky enough to have a sandwich course. So it meant that I had people or sponsors who were going to employ me. They didn't employ me by my academic results. My academic results in first year were awful, as you would expect, from not being particularly engaged. So I worked at Pesmenko and worked at the Sulphide Corp. And there was a guy called Arthur Good, who was an older engineer who was very wise, and he mentored me. For the very first time ever, I actually understood what chemical engineering was. I discovered engineering problem solving, and I got my kicks out of that. I thought that was fantastic. So I came back enthused from my first job placement and came back to university, and then there was more maths and more of all these other things that I wasn't interested in. And so again, it was this massive struggle. What do I do with uni? Who am I? What am I meant to be doing? And so I soldiered on until I got to my third year placement, which was at BHP. And I got to water pot plants, dust them occasionally, maybe take a fax, because fax machines were really new back then. And I'd take the fax from the blast furnace over the coke ovens and fax it and then walk back and take up half an hour that way. I shoveled a lot of coke. I wasn't engaged. Very, very fortunately, a guy called Ernie Walpole. Now, Ernie Walpole is a memory to some of you guys. Perhaps one of the worst lecturers that there ever was at this university, but absolutely the best mentor. This
I think Ernie Walpole is a precursor to Alex's work.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'll cover Osbeck up. Ernie Walpole chose to argue with me. I don't know why, but one day he just put me on the spot, said, "You're slacking," and he just continued to argue with me and badgered me. Best thing that could ever have happened to me. His arguments were creative, they were good, they were rational, they were intellectual, and for the first time ever, I was actually engaged in what I was doing. And I think this was about third year. I then got a job with Auspac Gold, working with Ernie, and my marks improved by about 25%. And so it shows what a difference when you start to be engaged in what you're doing. And it's to my embarrassment that it took me 3 and a bit years to work out what a chemical engineer was, what a chemical engineer does, and that in fact I was one. I'm glad and I'm thankful for Ernie Walpole. When I left university, I worked for Tundra for about a year. I went to BHP, and I remember on their site report it said that I had latent potential. Latent potential means that you're a slacker, okay? So that's how I got started at BHP. I went to the coke ovens. They hadn't had an engineer working there for about 5 years, working as an engineer. Everything was broken. And I don't mean that as, to try and, be poetic. I mean, everything was broken. And so that's the great opportunity. When you're smart and everything's broken, you can fix things. And we slowly went around fixing the coal quality, the coke quality, the reliability of the machines, and we built up quite a good performance. And so all of a sudden, instead of being a no-hoper, I was an achiever. So something happened. What happened? I grew up. You know what? You guys have a choice of when you grow up. It's actually your responsibility. It's better to grow up earlier than later. I just grew up a little later than some of you guys. The other thing that happened is I learnt that engineering is not about nuts, bolts, temperature and pressure. It's actually about people. Anything that you need to achieve, you achieve through people. Now that's not something that I learnt at uni, it's something that I learnt at BHP. Why did I learn at a BHP? Because I was staff. And you know what people think of staff when you go to BHP? They're the enemy. Okay? It's a hostile industrial environment and you have to negotiate that. I caused a strike by picking up some tools within 2 days of getting to the coke ovens. So, you know, I was labelled, I was marked. But through that, it gives you the opportunity to work out who you are and what you need to do, and it shapes you. However, if you're smart, you learn from a mentor who teaches you these things, you don't have to go through the pain yourself. So I worked for BHP for a little while. Because I was a poor student in my first degree, and I knew I could do better, it wasn't a case of ability, it was more of a case of distraction. I enrolled in a PhD back here in 1994, but it was on coke and coal and refractory bricks, and it's around some of the problems that we were looking at the coke ovens. Chemical engineering wasn't interested in coke and coal back then or refractories, and so I did my degree with Master's Engineer with a mech eng. I still consider myself a chem eng disciple, if you like, and it was just a twist of fate that allowed that to occur. BHP in 1996 decided that they were no longer going to be in the coke making market in Newcastle, and so the funding for the assays for the test work that I was doing was withdrawn, and so I had to finish my PhD as a master's thesis, and that was a bit of a disappointment, but it wasn't such a disappointment that I could remember to even turn up to my own graduation. Because there's so much going on at the closure of the steelworks, there's so much activity. I forgot to even turn up to my own graduation. That work that we did was good work, and it later got submitted to as a Regional Engineering Excellence Award and won an award in 1998. I'm very proud of that. By age 30, I was an international consultant going to various steelworks across the world, talking about coke and coal, and bricks, and safety and environment. And I became acutely aware that engineers are quite inefficient. There's lots of efficiencies. You can define efficiency as return on capital. You can look at it as input versus output in terms of coal. But I'm talking about in terms of energy and impact on the environment. And coke making was quite a destructive process. So after the steelworks, I went and worked for ADI. I was a operations engineer there for a while. Later became head of section, which is in BHP terms, a superintendent. I was a continuous improvement manager for a site. I was a rocket scientist, and you know, that's not a great extension for chemical engineering. Chemical engineering, if you do your physics and your maths well and you understand what you're doing, then it's not a big extension. You can do it. You have the ability. The training here is good. But the reality is I was still bored and frustrated. Maybe this is a bit of a sad tale, but it's true. So every holidays I could get, and I took some time off without pay, I went to China and worked on OSAID projects looking at pollution reduction in China. That work won an industry award in 2002, and that was the Datong Cleaner Environment Project. It inspired me to start my own company, which we did in 2002, to work on similar issues. How do we as a people use our resources more sustainably? How do we be better engineers? Out of all of that, there's some life lessons, and I just wanted to read them for you, and hopefully they can encourage you. They're very similar to what the others have said, but again, reinforcement, you know, having something repeated and repeated and repeated, hopefully it might get in, and you'll learn these things 5 years ahead of what I did. Okay, first one, don't be arrogant. If you don't understand your course or your course's content or what you're doing at work, talk to your boss, talk to your lecturer. They are not mind readers. They do not understand your frustrations. They do not understand where you are in terms of your lostness. Okay? So the obligation to work out where you are is actually yours. Don't think that the university is not doing a good job or the course is irrelevant or I don't understand where it all fits in. That's not their problem. It's actually yours. First thing, I wish I knew that when I was 18 or 17. Get a mentor. People who are older and wiser than you who have been through this type of stuff can often help. If you get an Ernie Walpole, you will be blessed. Get someone who will creatively argue with you, who will challenge you, who will lift you up and make you better. Value your older colleagues, even if they are fat, bald and grey. Put your effort into your study now. I regret my first degree's performance. Don't regret what you do. Live in the moment. Today is the day that you need to put your effort into your studies. Not in 2 years or 3 years or 4 years' time think I should have done better. You only get one chance at this. Well, sorry, most of us only get one chance at this. Thankfully, and I think someone else said this, employers don't look at academic results. And I'm very grateful for that because Arthur Good chose to accept me after my first year's results. And whilst it was a minor turning point and it wasn't the turning point, it was a significant event for me because I would have gone and done an arts degree if I hadn't. So, yeah, put your effort into your study, but learn the concepts. The employers out there, they're not interested in people who can rote learn or parrot learn texts or proofs. You know, I remember, for example, doing heat transfer and looking at, the proof of how you might set out something that you just look up at a book in five seconds. You know, we don't need that type of learning. What we need is people who are engaged in concepts. And if you can understand the concepts, they can take you to a huge variety of places. You are not limited in your chemical engineering degree. You are opening up the world, and you have a huge opportunity. That I've learned is you need to give back to your profession. You need to give back to your uni, to your colleagues. After all, life is about doing stuff in teams. And teamwork and working with people and learning how people work is an important part of life's lessons. And it's certainly absolutely not about nuts, bolts, pressure and temperature. I believed when I came out of this uni that it was all about the metallurgy and the process. That's not true. Thoughts for the future. You guys can help the world become more sustainable and more equitable. Because you're chemical engineers, you have a great opportunity to solve intractable problems. You know, I think you guys need to go out into the world and be awesome.